Good morning. Welcome to St. Patrick's. We have a couple of announcements. Altar Service and other ministry volunteers, please pick up your gifts of appreciation in the sacristy after Mass. We are grateful for all you do to support the parish. And join us for our monthly parish rosary on Sunday, January 7th, after the 10:30 Mass. There will be no collection, but there are baskets at the front and the back of the church for collections and donations. Let us begin our prayer by singing hymn number 199, Immaculate Mary.
Everyone.
Good morning, Father.
We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, as we join together on the solemnity of the Mother of God, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
We gather today to celebrate the lowly handmaid who brought eternal life into the world. Lord Jesus, born under the law, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, born of Mary, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, only begotten Son, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Amen.
Have mercy on us.
For
us pray. O God, who through the fruitful virginity of Blessed Mary bestowed on the human race the grace of eternal salvation, grant, we pray, that we may experience the intercession of her through whom we were found worthy to receive the author of life, our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Numbers. The Lord said to Moses, "Speak to Aaron and his sons and tell them, this is how you shall bless the Israelites. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord let his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you kindly and give you peace. So shall they invoke my name upon the Israelites, and I will bless them." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The nations on the earth you guide.
May God bless us in his mercy.
May the peoples praise you, O God. May all the peoples praise you. May God bless us. And may all the ends of the earth fear him.
May God bless us in his mercy.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Galatians. Brothers and sisters, when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to ransom those under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. As proof that you are sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying out, "Abba, Father." So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then also an heir through God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. The shepherds went in haste to Bethlehem and found Mary and Joseph and the infant lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known the message that they had been told about this child. All who heard it were amazed by what had been told them by the shepherds. And Mary kept all these things, reflecting on them in her heart. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, just as it had been told to them. When 8 days were completed for his circumcision, he was named Jesus, the name given him by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Happy 2024, everyone. I get to see you now next year, because next year is now. Isn't that wonderful? But as we celebrate again a new year, I don't know how many of you stayed up late last night or whatever else. I stayed up late, but I just prayed. So, I mean, whatever. I mean, if you were doing something else, I'm just glad you're here this morning. How's that? But as we celebrate and we kind of come into this new year, you know, there might be optimism, but there also might be a lot of pessimism. And I'm willing to bet there's at least a mixture of it in each and every person's heart as we join together this morning. And it can be very, very trying because we look at our world, we look at the chaos within, we look at the chaos, like, you know, just on our local level, and then forget the world. I mean, it's completely out of sorts right now. And then we might sit there and go, well, what do we do? What can we do? Where do we even turn in the midst of this chaotic world? Well, my friends, I think it's a safe bet to kind of take in that this day that we're starting with together is not accidental. This feast day of Mary, the Mother of God, a title that was hard won for her at, again, that Council of Ephesus in 431, is something that's very important to understand, because she herself gave birth to the divine Savior, to God incarnate. And because of that, she has always had a particular level of honor within the entirety of the church. But that honor has taken on even a more full expression in, dare I say, the past 500 years. Because what started in the past 500 years? Well, the Lord has kind of pushed our Blessed Mother forward into the foreground to intercede on our behalf in a particular way. It all started just south of our borders in the better part of 1531 when Our Lady first appeared to Juan Diego, and we had this celebration of Our Lady of Guadalupe, the patroness of the Americas. This image that still exists to this day in modern day Mexico on basically what would be the equivalent of something like this, except much cheaper, and it was just an outer garment of St. Juan Diego, and it should have broke down, I don't know, probably about 480 years ago, as it were. But here it is still today, sitting above that. That image had such an impact on the people, was so meaningful to them and their culture, that where there were no inroads of Christianity in the first place, over the Aztec, the Mayan religions, all these things, 10 million converted, basically, when this image came about. And that's just the start of it. Because over the years, Our Lady has continued to show up in various places across the globe, trying basically to do one thing and one thing alone. First, let us know that we are loved, because she is our mother as well. We understand this from St. John standing at the foot of the cross and standing in the person of all of us. Jesus says to the beloved disciple, "Behold your mother." She is that mother for all of us, and she cares deeply about us, her spiritual children. And she's trying to make sure that when push comes to shove, we end up home with our Lord in the eternal bliss that is heaven. But the world has become more challenging, and we've been tended to turn more our hearts more over, not to the things of God, but to the things of the world. So here she comes intervening in all these places. And she's intervened in particular in our own time in a very, very profound way over the last 100 years. It was just last summer I got to go again to the apparition site of Our Lady of Fatima. Everybody know the story, generally speaking, of Our Lady of Fatima. Our Lady appears multiple times on the 13th of the month from May to October, ultimately culminating with what's called the Miracle of the Sun. This miracle that was witnessed not only by the visionaries, but by the better part of 125,000 people scattered across the countryside, many of them not proud professing Catholics, but basically playing for the opposite side. They were turned over to the secular world and looked at Christianity as a fool's errand and everything else. And even they wrote in the newspaper of the time, basically the equivalent of our own modern day, the Telegram or the Boston Globe or whatever, we can't explain what we just saw. There's testimonies of this all over the place, of Our Lady confirming her appearance. One of the things she revealed to the shepherd children is something that I think applies to what we're looking at today in what would give us this pessimism we're talking about. Namely, the fact that one of the requests was that the Pope would consecrate Russia to her Immaculate Heart. Now, this was supposed to happen very soon after the events of Our Lady of Fatima in 1917. You want to know when we actually, give or take, pulled it off? March 25th, 1984. Whoops. And lest we were not completely sure, it was redone not too long ago by Pope Francis as well. Gives you an idea of how important this is. But the main part of it is this. She said if this didn't happen in time, Russia, which at the time was known as Holy Russia when this was going on, but what wasn't known by the world yet was that the Bolshevik Revolution was about to turn up and get into high gear, that Russia would spread her errors throughout the world, and that this would happen to the point where the world would be in some dire straits. Well, if you take a look at what's going on in the world today, the fact we can't even identify objective truth anymore, that my truth ain't your truth, ain't her truth, ain't their truth, ain't whoever's truth, that we can't agree on anything, that we can't even converse with one another on the most basic elements of life, I would say it's come to pass that the errors have spread. Because that was going on in the midst of Russia that became the Soviet Union for quite a long time. But there was a part at the end, dear friends, that I think is the one that I would say should give us hope as we stand here today in 2024. Something a little audacious maybe, but I still hold to it. And that is, she said all that she said about Russia spreading through her errors throughout the world, but she said at the end, in the end, my Immaculate Heart will triumph. My Immaculate Heart will triumph. What does that mean? What that means for you and I, dear friends, is that as bleak as things can get, as tiresome as things can get, as heavy as the crosses that can land upon our shoulders can be, there is always, always, always hope. And it is something to lean into in these times to understand that there is great hope going on. Because no matter what it is, this triumph of Our Lady's Immaculate Heart, whatever it manifests itself as, whenever it shows up on the scene, it will be a game-changing thing. Somehow, some way, however it manifests itself, there will be a course correction in our world. And something will occur to start to correct all that has gone on over the better part of these last 100+ years. And we will start to move towards something based upon the fact that heaven doesn't lie. And we talk so much about our Lord and the gift that he has of love for us. But Our Lady, her one goal for each and every one of us is to bring her closer to her Son, because she knows him better than anybody. She was there at the beginning. She was there at the end of his life. She was there everywhere in between. And she was there at the birthing of the church, teaching the apostles to do what? To open their hearts so profoundly to God that the Holy Spirit rushed upon them, and they went from the cowering nature that they were prior to Pentecost out to proclaiming the gospel to the detriment of their lives, because the Holy Spirit, the same Holy Spirit that had caused God to enter into time and space, was now in their hearts in such a profound way that they were ready to act. You, dear friends, have received this gift as I have. It's called the sacrament of confirmation. It is a gift that gives us that same Holy Spirit that gives us the ability to be those instruments of God in his holy hands in the midst of this chaotic world, to allow our Blessed Mother to intercede and draw us in to that identity that we are truly are in his eyes, and to be able to move on towards the mission he has designed us for. That gift of her drawing us close to her Son is something that is meant especially for priests and religious in particular, because of the fact that she is going to be the one that keeps us on track so that we don't fall into all these other ways of misinterpreting Jesus. That's why St. Louis de Montfort said it this way: Marian consecration is the surest, quickest, fastest way to become a saint, because she won't lead you astray. She'll lead you directly to him in his authenticity. We have a pathway forward, friends. But the question is, on this beginning of the new year, is are we willing to take advantage of it? I'm sure some of you are making resolutions right now. For some of us, it's going to be, shall we say, trying to take care of certain visible elements and moving them in the other direction, such that the Knights of Columbus are going to be beating me up over this once we start that Biggest Loser thing in 2 days' time. Some of the Knights of Columbus going, oh, you're doing this? This is news to me. It's okay. But if you're going to make any resolutions, my friend, let's make a resolution to bring the Mother of God into things, to allow her to work in our hearts. Perhaps you've never consecrated yourself to Our Lady or to Jesus through Mary, as it ultimately is authentically known. What better time to do it than now? Perhaps, again, we've not picked up the rosary because of the fact it's like, it's one of those things, it seems superfluous, like you're saying the same prayers over and over again. My friends, there's a depth to the rosary that goes beyond the praying of the same prayers over and over again. It's the mysteries themselves that our hearts are meant to be drawn towards. And I would say that would be a good one, too, to bring up as we begin this new year. Perhaps that, again, it's just the weight of all of these things that are on us as we go forward. Maybe it's with ourselves. Maybe it's with loved ones. Maybe it's with family members. I don't know what's going on in your life right now, dear friends, but I would say that if we have those difficulties, let's turn it over to our Blessed Mother and let her intercede. One of the things you come to find out is that, again, why not just go to Jesus directly? Why go to Our Lady? Imagine somebody who knows Jesus so well that she can arrange your prayer almost like in a perfect way that it's received even that much more by him. And then imagine that, I don't know how many of you are sons in the room. You've been a son at some point, I'm assuming, for many of the men in this room. When mom approaches you, do you really want to say no? Not often. Maybe some of you do, like going, Father, you don't know me. It's okay. But imagine now the most perfect mother who's ever lived coming to her divine son and making a request. Do you think Jesus wants to say no? Of course not. That's why we take our intentions to her. And I leave you with this, my friends. One of the big battlegrounds we face in the world is the battle in our own families. For every one of us who are here, we know family members and loved ones who maybe aren't this morning, or maybe are just distant from God, distant from the church, everything else. And that can weigh deeply upon our hearts. But I want to kind of tie it all back in to this triumph of the Immaculate Heart this morning. And it goes back to a story from 1984, when I was about a year away from being born. Some of you in the room just went, "You're wicked old, Father." Some of you in the room just went, "Dear Lord, stop, Father. I don't want to hear that." But there was this story. It was a cardinal of church, Cardinal Kafar. At the time, he was just a Monsignor, but he had been put in charge of the John Paul II Pontifical Institute for Marriage and the Family, something that was very close to the saint's heart that he was trying to help in the course of his time out during the papacy. But as Cardinal Kafar reported many years later, again, he just died in the past few years, he reported this story about how he noticed that it wasn't just the outside world that was attacking, but there was battles within the church over these things. And he just noticed that no matter what he did, there was battlegrounds coming all around him. So he had this moment where he's just like, "I need help. I need people to pray for me. I need people to pray for this institute because we're just getting, you know, taken out every corner we turn." And so he had this moment of just realization, "I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to reach out to the last person who was at Fatima, who was a religious sister at the time, Sister Lucia. She died in 2005. And he said it in the letter, in short, "I don't expect a response back. I just want you to pray for this because it's just very hard right now on all of us trying to get this thing off the ground." And he sent it along through the proper channels because you have to send it in a specific way because otherwise everybody's going to be sending mail to her. To his surprise, 3 weeks later, he received a handwritten response. And there was a lot in the letter that he did not disclose, but there was one thing he did. And it's this little line that, again, gives you an idea of the battle we face, but also the hope we live in because of our Blessed Mother acting on our behalf. And it's something to ponder as we enter this new year. She said to him, "Father, a time will come when the decisive battle between the kingdom of Christ and Satan will be over marriage and the family. And those who work for the good of the family will experience persecution and tribulation. But do not be afraid. Do not be afraid, because Our Lady has already crushed his head." Friends, live in hope. It might get trying. It might get cumbersome. It might be a days where we're carrying our cross just like the Lord. But I assure you, those words of Our Lady, "Do not be afraid, Our Lady has already crushed his head," that is our reality. There is a triumph of the Immaculate Heart coming. And let us carry that in our hearts as we enter into this new year of 2024. Let us stand now and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Lifting our hearts and minds before the Lord, let us offer all of our prayers on this feast day of the Mother of God.
That the leaders of the world combine effort to work for world peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayer. That ecclesiastical leaders grow in appreciation of the vital contributions of women in the church, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayer. That mothers throughout the world will be strengthened by the Blessed Mother's life of willingness to heed to God's will, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who care for children will regard their vocation as a sacred trust from God, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our mission parish in Haiti, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who are sick or near death and those who care for them know the reality of God's love through this community's support, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those friends and loved ones who's gone before us into the embrace of our Lord's arms, whom we'll remember in this liturgy, and this morning for Kenneth Stidson, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who are suffering under conflict in their homeland, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all the intentions of our parish prayer chain, and for all of those prayers that each and every one of us holds deep in our own hearts that are known only to God. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father in heaven, you open to us all of the gifts of grace and mercy that you wish us to receive. And through our Blessed Mother Mary, you teach us how to open ourselves to those gifts to grow in holiness of life, that we may one day see you for all eternity in your heavenly kingdom. Live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
As our gifts are brought to the altar, let us join together in singing hymn number 707, Hail Mary, Gentle Woman.
Pray for us sinners now, and
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
O God, who in your kindness began all good things and bring them to fulfillment, grant to us who find joy in the solemnity of the Holy Mother of God, that just as we glory in the beginnings of your grace, so one day we may rejoice in its completion. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and eternal God, and to praise, bless, and glorify your name on the solemnity of the motherhood of the Blessed Ever Virgin Mary. For by the overshadowing of the Holy Spirit, she conceived your only begotten Son, and without losing the glory of virginity, brought forth into the world the eternal light, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him the angels praise your majesty, dominions adore and powers tremble before you. Heaven and the virtues of heaven and the blessed seraphim worship together with exaltation. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in humble praise as we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy.
to you. Therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant, Francis our Pope, and Robert our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, and on the Catholic and Apostolic faith, remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, what they offered for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and the hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious Ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. Live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us now offer each other a sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Now for the prayer of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I
believe that
you are present
in the most holy sacrament.
I love you above all things,
and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you are already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Mary, did you know
this is the body of
that your baby?
The body of
one
Christ.
Day walk on water.
This is the body of Christ.
Mary, did you
receive the body of Christ?
That your
this is the body of Christ.
Would save our sons
receive the body
and
of Christ.
Daughters.
This
did
is the body
you
of Christ.
That your receive baby boy has come
this is the body of
to make you.
Body of Christ.
This child that you
deliver, this is the body
will
of Christ.
Soon deliver you.
This is the body of Christ.
Mary, did you know
the body of
that your baby boy?
This is the body of Christ.
Give sight to
the
blind man. Mary, did
this
you
the body of
know?
Christ.
That your
Savior
calm a storm with his hand. Did you know that your baby boy
this is the
has
body
walked
Christ.
Where angels trod?
Receive the body of Christ.
And when you kiss your little
this is the body of Christ.
Baby,
this is the body of Christ.
You kiss the face
of
God.
This is the body of Christ. This is the body of Christ. See the body of Christ. See the body of Christ. Receive the body of Christ. Receive the body of Christ. This is the body of Christ.
The blind
this is the body
will see,
of Christ.
The deaf will
this
hear,
is the, body of Christ.
The dead will live.
the body of
Mary,
Christ.
Mary, did you know
this is the body of Christ? This is the body of Christ.
All creation.
Mary,
did you know that your baby
this is the body of Christ
would one day rule the nation? Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect bride?
Mary, this is the body of Christ.
The sleeping child you're holding is a
let us pray. We have received this heavenly sacrament with joy, O Lord. Grant, we pray, that it may lead us to eternal life, for we rejoice to proclaim the Blessed Ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of your Son and Mother of the Church, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle.
Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil.
May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan
and all the evil spirits who prowl around the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit. Bow your heads, pray for God's blessing.
May God, the source and origin of all blessing, grant you grace, pour out his blessing in abundance, and keep you safe from harm throughout the year. Amen.
Amen.
May he give you integrity in faith, endurance in hope, and perseverance in charity, with holy patience to the end. Amen.
Amen.
May he order your days and your deeds in his peace. Grant your prayers in this and in every place, and lead you happily to eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Our celebration is ended. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life. Thanks be to God.
Happy New Year, everyone.
Happy New Year, Father.
As we go forth together, let us sing hymn number 531. Let there be peace on earth.